No Notes. Good evening. Welcome to another episode of the No Notes Show. Thanks for joining us this evening. Tonight, we have a special guest back on our show, Mr. Antwaun Gay. And if you recall Antwaun, he first came to us and we interviewed him a few months back. And so now he's back to join us once again with another good topic of discussion. And first, before we get to that, it's been a couple changes with Antwaun. He's made a move. I'm just asking him to mention his new location before we get started. But first, before we do that, we'd like to welcome him back. What's up, Antwaun? How you doing?
How you doing, Steve? What's up, Doc?
Peace, love, and soul.
So, how you doing?
Nice to be back in the house.
It's great to have you back in the house, man. And so tell us, where are you coming in from this time, as we come around to this one?
Oh, say it again?
Tell us where you coming in from this time. Last time you were in a different location, but tell us where you come from this time.
Okay, this time I'm from Fredericksburg, Virginia. Just a step over from Stafford, so all I did was just jump over the county line, that's all.
Okay,
From the county to the city.
Okay, there you go. All right.
Is he still involved in the correctional?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, okay.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Still, that hasn't changed. It's okay. Just some other things have changed. But let's get right into our topic this evening. And what we're going to be talking about is Jail Street Mentalities and how this has an effect on our youth. And that's why we brought Antwaun back, because he is in this this line of work, working with youth, working with young men to help better themselves as they have strayed away, so to speak, but now have a time to come to a place to work with Antwaun to get themselves together. So, I'm going to pass off the mic to Antwaun and let him jump right into it.
All right. Jail and street mentalities. Just some of the things that we kind of discussed just a little bit on the phone. Some of the things that we've seen as prevalent, especially in our jails and prison system, is a mindset. A mindset that is definitely not... It's counterproductive to their life, to stability, to family, to culture. And many of these things has either generated in the prison or out in the street. And our youth tend to gravitate to these things. And working in the prison system for a number of years, or jail system, and in the prison system, especially in the last 8 years working with the juveniles that I work with, many of them have, of course, come from broken families, broken homes.
Right.
But their mind is saturated with gang life, thuggery, and the type of things that come with the street gang mentality, the no snitching rule, gang glorification, disrespect for women. And again, they all, majority of them, white or black or Hispanic that comes through, or Latino that comes through our prison, they love hip hop. Some form or fashion, they're connected to it, and they eat and breathe it. And so I believe the things that happen in the street, things that happen in the jail, and things that is marketed, that comes across that TV in the form of video or through the radio stations is definitely impacting our youth today and causing a brainwashed or jail street mentality and affecting kids who hasn't either been to jail or haven't been to prison or been involved in a gang or in the street. They are being affected by it. And okay. So we're finding all across the country, no matter what the race is, that type of mentality is affecting our youth in a dangerous unproductive way.
So once they come in, they feel like they're coming in now. Now they're preparing to serve their time, but they're bringing this thought thought process in with them, this mentality that they feel like, I guess, and this is a question, that they feel like that they must carry on no matter what. Is that basically where they're coming from, their perspective?
Ask the last part of that question one more time.
In terms of where they've been, they got themselves into a situation.
Okay.
Now they're coming in, they're preparing themselves, you know, they had to serve their time. And so the mentality, they're bringing in that same mentality off the street along with them, feeling as though that they must carry this on or this view on even inside as they serve their time. Is that pretty much what's going on?
Yes, it definitely reinforces the mindset.
Okay.
Because even if you're not part of a gang or you're part of a criminal element, if you've got locked up on some charges to get you into that facility or that place, the culture inside perpetuates the mentality. You know, it forces some people who weren't knowers, if some people weren't involved in gangs, they feel pressure to become involved in gangs once they get in there.
Okay.
So again, it just starts reinforcing things. And so you may have, there's many people, this is why, again, our society has got to come to points to realize is that many people, many young adults that can be handled in a different way. Once you send them into the jail prison system, sometimes they pick up stuff that they didn't have before.
Okay.
And a lot of times at gang or jail mentality, and then when they get out, they come out worse than when they went in.
Correct.
They may have GED, they may be more educated, but if you don't get that mentality out, they just go back out and they might have built some jail credibility while they're in there. They might have connected or networked with someone who they want to try to connect when they get back out in the street.
Right.
Yeah, that's true.
I know Doc has a question. I'm gonna swing it to him.
Basically primarily what you were saying is true, but in actuality, when you go to jail, you're actually going to a finishing school, for lack of a better word. In other words, jail more or less reinforces the street cred, and vice versa. It's like when you go to jail, jail is like a finishing school. It's like a college. You go to learn how to be a criminal, because in jail you have your house rules, so to speak, certain things you do and you don't do. And basically, it's consistent with the street cred. But by the same token, not to hang it all on hip hop, but hip hop. If you listen to hip hop sort of glorifies all the criminal acts, and like in Kobe's case back in the day, you can't rap unless you have street cred. They said Kobe was too squeaky clean. He came up in a blue blood family. He came from the wealthy family, so they said he couldn't rap. I mean, what could he say? You know,
because of his background.
You got to come from a street base.
Right, right.
You know,
right.
drugs, you know, that type of thing.
Right.
So, you know, you really have to, it's like getting your street cred.
Right. So, Antwaun, these young men coming in with this mindset, what's your first approach to reaching out to them, I guess, in terms of send a message to let them know that, okay, that was the street, now you're in here, now you're in a different type of environment, now it's time to adapt a whole new type of mindset. What's your first approach to that?
My first approach, I think I kind of touched on last time, first of all, it's trying to build that rapport.
Right.
Because as a teacher or if I'm a correctional officer, my job dictates that I do my job first. So sometimes the mindset coming in, they don't want to really hear too much talk. Or, you know, if I'm trying to get them to inspire them to do their work, a lot of them not even motivated to do work. So you have to, somehow a conversation is built where you can start building rapport. Or they ask you a question, and then it spurs some type of conversation. then, you know, I can go ahead and I start off maybe wherever they're at. So if it's talking about music, you know, they may ask me a question. What do I feel about Young Jeezy or Lil Wayne or whatever? Do I listen to hip hop?
Right.
And from there, I let them know what kind of hip hop I listen to. And when I mention to them that, you know, hey, I may respect the artistic ability of a Lil Wayne or of a Jeezy or some of the other guys out there, I don't listen to their lyrics because their lyrics
derogatory.
For my soul, not good for my mind.
Right. Okay.
And so then again, it gets into why is that? Why do you think that their lyrics are wrong?
Okay. But that's,
I'm going to talk about how, again, to the things of how it's counterproductive to who they are.
But that's a very good point you brought out. The fact that you were in tune, that you're aware of Lil Wayne and Jeezy and the other guys, I can't think of all their names right now, that gives you a little credibility because you are in tune. That opens up the communication line. You know, yes. But again, it goes back to the fact that they for some reason, they feel that's the real world. They feel as though they're keeping it real. When they talk about drugs and women and what have you, that to them is being real. That's the real world in their eyes.
Mm-hmm. And they'll come in and they'll tell you. I mean, you hear the stories that they tell you. You don't understand why the rappers and some of the R&B singers are saying, this is for my men in the streets. Yeah. They'll tell you that they're playing these songs.
Exactly.
For my brothers, for my ends in the street. Uh-huh. And so they're talking about these songs, and then you listen to the testimonies of these young men that come to the prison. They are truly doing these things that a lot of rappers aren't doing themselves, but they keep talking about it. And so, and they're not just talking about it, they're glorifying it.
Exactly, because if you ever heard Diddy, and I think and JC said it in an interview or conversation that running a corporation is like slinging drugs, like selling drugs on the street. So what they're saying is that they all, the ones that have made it, they're all saying that at some point in their career or their lives, they sold drugs on the street.
Yeah.
Or they were busted or they went to jail. So that's almost like saying that's the way you pay your dues to get it where you want to be in the rap world. You got to have some sort of contact with the cops. You got to have contact with drugs. You got to be involved in vice. You know, you got to do all these things in order for you to rap.
Yes, and that's why guys like Lupe Fiasco, you know, he's not getting, who's an awesome rapper, who's not getting, and then all the gospel rappers is out here who have similar testimonies, come from the same background, some of the same streets, but they're not singing or rapping songs that are detrimental to themselves or their people. They don't get record play. They don't get airplay.
Right, right.
So then you got to deal with the record company that's over top of these rappers and artists, and who are they, and why are they making them or encouraging them to continue to sing or rap what they're rapping. And so again, it goes back to that jail mentality, the saggy
bands. Right.
Constantly calling each other the N-word.
Exactly.
All that's coming through the disrespectful women. All that's coming through and affecting our youth. And the media does play a big time part in that.
Oh, they do.
As well as the street and then the cycle coming in and out of the prison system, all of them are correlated.
And I see, just rewinding a little bit to what you were saying, that's where the brainwashing comes in at, because you just said they feel like they listen to these songs and everything. They feel like they're being directly spoken to. And this is, and whatever is being portrayed in the song or whatever is being said in the song, okay, this is the role that I need to be in. This is how I need to act on the streets. This is what I need to do in order to survive. So if you allow, if you consume it that way, you interpret it that way, then of course you're allowing yourself to be brainwashed into a thinking mentality that's incorrect. So that's quite deep. It's quite deep how you just analyze that right there.
It's you constantly hear. I mean, again, going back to it's not just the media, but the media does play a serious part in this. The music industry does.
Right.
When it's rap and hip hop is predominantly black Latino culture. I mean, it's people of color the majority that are rapping and singing. And again, it's the companies. The company, the TV, the radio stations that are producing and pumping it out, they don't care about the residual effects, but yet they always want to talk about it. KRS-One, who doesn't do gangster rap anymore, Doc, you mentioned something about me being able to relate to the young guys. So I mentioned something one of the rap songs that KRS-One used to say, like, when some punk jumps up to get beat down, broken down to his very last compound. Mm-hmm. See how that sounds a little irrational? A lot of MCs like to use the word dramatic. And so when I say that, it's okay. The first thing he smiles, okay, he can spit a little bit. I said, that's not my rhyme, that's KRS-One.
Right, okay.
But same KRS-One doesn't talk that way anymore. And Lackman came into his mind and realized the stuff that he was saying was detrimental to himself.
Right.
And to his people. And when he look out in the street and he sees the prisons filled up, that what he was saying was not beneficial. And that it was a brainwashing.
Right.
But then one of the greatest lyricists don't get any airplay anymore.
Okay. Right.
Because he doesn't engage his himself anymore.
Right. Exactly.
And it's confusing to the youth when person, and I don't want to just blame them totally, they get awards. We award them with awards and trophies and do radio shows for doing it. And you listen to the lyrics, and this is all that's going through the youth's mind, and you wonder, why are the youth doing what they're doing? Why we have what we have in the inner cities? And you listen, you ask them who they're listening to, what they're watching, it, and I'm telling you, it's the same people. That they want to emulate, they want to be like, and it's not the same heroes, Doc, I'm sure, as you had, and maybe that I had when I was at least in elementary school age.
Right.
So it was more Michael Jackson, it might have been Cool in the Gang, it might have been Michael Jordan, it might have been Ali, but as time went on, when I got into my late teens, and BET, MTV came out, and you had, NWA, and Ice Cube, and LL, and I mean, rap still had its vainness, its bounds, but it had many different rappers that had different messages that you could choose from.
Right,
but then it was pretty much the same stuff. Right.
But then where rap sort of went astray is like when LL Cool J, those type of guys were rapping, that was more kosher type of rapping. It's when they came up with the so-called gangster rap. That's when it went off into the N-word, the cussing. That's when it got out there where, it's just out of control now. But prior to that, when rap first came on the scene and you had a Public Enemy and people like that, they had a constructive message and was very positive. It's only when they got into the so-called gangster rap, when he started doing the 50 Cents and the Jay-Z's and it started getting repulsive then.
You had more of a variety. Hip-hop, definitely, during that time period, had more variety of rappers. You had your gangster rappers, you had your party rappers, you had your club, strip club rappers, but then you had rappers, they weren't Christian, they were, a little bit of Nation of Islam, but even the regardless of their faith, you had rappers that would talk about the mindset of getting a job, of leaving the gang life alone, thinking about family, reuniting. Even Tupac himself, he had his wild side, he did at times, he would relate in songs like Dear Mama.
Yeah.
I'm not mad at you. And I guess in that song, he talks about how after he got killed in the video, how his buddy changed. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. But even Tupac himself, who had the dichotomy, the struggle in him between wanting to glorify the craziness and then trying to make a cultural and a cultural difference to his people. He struggled with that himself. But one of the quotes he mentioned, I'm paraphrasing, he said that artists do have a responsibility on what they write or on what they say, because it doesn't matter in the end whether or not they, something to affect another, it didn't matter whether or not they did or not. The question comes in, did you save them? Did you say something to save them? And I don't have the exact quote, I'll maybe give it to you another time, but it was a powerful quote that Tupac said when he realized that his lyrics did have impact on other people's lives, and that it was important for him to say something to try to save somebody's life.
Right.
But he battled with himself.
Right. Now, I'm sorry, go ahead. You about to say, you about to add something to that?
No, that was it. Just that, it's just, these are the things, again, whether it be the gang glorification, the no snitch rule, that's in hip hop. Again, it's not all about, this whole conversation is not all about hip hop, you know, I keep mentioning it. But whether it's in hip hop, whether it's in the jail, whether it's in the street, that no snitch rule, and crimes can't be corrected.
Right. Antwaun?
You still with us?
There we go.
Trump outside of the jail into the street and into our homes and into our schools. And become prevalent throughout our nation.
Well, let me ask you this. Now, breaking through, going back to our topic, there's a wall there. You know, once youth, young men come in, there's that wall. They still feel like they got to uphold for their reputation, for a number of other things, you know, for their image. How long is there a time frame of where it takes for you to do what you do, to break through that wall, break through that barrier, to get through that mentality, to showing the person that there's another side, or there's another way of thinking that's more positive, that'll help you develop. I guess it's probably not, because everybody's different.
That's right.
But overall, I mean, is it for the majority? Is it a very long process, or what's your perspective? How does that come out?
And that's a good question. It does vary from person to person, because many people come through, they do come from different backgrounds. Even though many of them have come from broken backgrounds, there's been a mama, a grandmother, a grandfather, somebody, an uncle, who was a positive role model in their life that was already sowing seeds into them prior to them doing what they did to get locked up.
Right.
And when I connect with those guys a lot of times say, yeah, you know, I've heard it before, you sound like my father, you sound like my mother, I heard my mom told me that. So it helps already that those seeds are planted.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But then there's those who don't, maybe didn't have that many seeds, and it's blaming them. And so it takes longer for them, a year or two. And then, unfortunately, they may see things somewhat differently, a lot differently, but they still a lot of times leave with some of that, if not a lot of that residue still in their mind.
Right, right.
And it's a hard thing to break. And so for some, the more conversation that I have in getting them to realize what they're constantly hearing and what they're constantly saying over their lives, how certain things take you down the road. It's your mentality, your thoughts. Your actions follow your thoughts.
Right.
So in getting them to kind of, you know, deal with some psychology of getting them to understand, again, whatever you have done, you thought about it first before you did it. So then think about what you were listening to. Think about some of the things that you, some of the advice, some of the rules that you followed. Where'd you get that from? That was in play. You didn't come out your mother's womb thinking that way.
Right.
So somehow you got in the way and you picked up things. And when you picked up those things, you would interpret those things as, this is who I am. But this is not who you are.
Right.
You haven't seen another picture. of who you are. If you can, as many of them can, they can quote to you some long rap songs. I'm talking about 3 or 4 or 5 minutes long, right off the top of the dome. Now I said, man, do you realize that you can give an awesome dissertation? You can be a great public speaker. You can be a great teacher. Give yourself the same information, you know, from these GED books, from these math books, from these science books, from these history books, and you can regurgitate the same thing without even having to look at your notes.
Right.
That light bulb goes
in. That makes you think, right?
But you know, back in the day, we had a disc jockey in Philadelphia by the name of Jocko Henderson, and he started up a school. And in his curriculum, what he did was he set it up through rap, because like you just said, they memorized that stuff like 1 or 2 times. They got it down like to a fine science. And my wife and I was talking not too long ago. If the school system for that caliber of teenager, they need to find something and present it in a rap form or format, because at first that gets their attention, and they'll take that challenge on more readily than if you try to do traditional, you know, teaching. But going back to a point that you made earlier, I think it's not the problem, but back in the day, there was an era when they said babies were having babies. And if you look at the kids today, and you trace it back, it goes back to the adults. Because the adults adults today want to be more of their kids' friends. They want to be able to say, my daughter and I like friends, my son and I like friends. You can't be a parent and a friend too, you know. Because at some point in time, you gotta, you know, show some authority. And if you're coming from a friend base, they don't respect that.
Right, because they're looking at you as a friend, somebody you on the street.
Their friend, right. Their peer can't chastise them. Their peer can't tell them what to do. So if you want to be a friend, you're more or less giving up your authority as a parent.
Right. And that brings me to my next question. You have Antwaun, you have an interesting message on your shirt there. You want to tell us a little bit about that? But first, for the audience, just tell us what it says. So, I mean, we can see it here on the screen, but the full message, just tell us what it says first, and then give us a little background.
What it says is just a shirt that I was wearing today, but... it says Handling Care, and so at the facility that I worked at, I was an instructor, and basically you teach people how to properly defend themselves and handle at-risk youth or young men. So.
So, right, because it's a certain protocol that's supposed to be followed.
Yes.
Pertaining to restraint and you know, handling situations that may be that could get out of control in your work environment, but how to restrain someone but do it gently without, you know, physically hurting a person or hurting yourself or causing harm to other people that may be in the area
to the best of your ability. Absolutely.
right to the best of your ability, of course, which is a task in itself, I'm sure.
Yes, but the big part of it, actually, and I found, if you don't mind me tying it into what we're talking about.
No, not at all.
Is the verbal part. Mm. It's learning to understand who you're dealing with. And the de-escalation, the verbal de-escalation of situations without necessarily having to put your hands on somebody.
Right.
Understanding, being able to recognize what's going on with that person. If they're not talking, if they're jittery, just different. I don't want to speak too much because it's a training and someone could use it and take it.
Right.
But it focuses on understanding first the individual and making sure that you have yourself under control. And when it comes down to the scripture in the Bible says, all that getting, get understanding. And I love that scripture. So when it comes down to understanding our youth and our young adults and what's affecting them, I'm tired of us constantly rehearsing the same conversations. What's wrong with our youth? What's wrong with our youth? When you know if you eat junk food, for your physical body,
right,
you're not going to be too healthy. You know what I'm saying? You're not going to be too healthy. You're not going to be strong if you don't eat vegetables, you don't eat a balanced diet. And so when we constantly see the bombarding of things that's coming through the TV, through the media, how we see ourselves a lot of times and how we speak, the things that we allow to go on, it's no wonder that this the kids, the youth, are picking up from the culture around them. And it's, I like getting, you know, I believe it's important to get to the root cause of things. And so even though myself being a Christian, I'm in line when it comes down to Farrakhan, when it comes down to getting to the nitty-gritty of some things that especially affect people of color. And it's turning off some of the stuff that's on the TV.
Right.
Whether it be what we call reality TV, which would be real.
Right.
Yeah. And right. Our young girls are mimicking the dress, the talk, the fights.
Right.
Talk about it in school. It's the same type of mentality. Mm-hmm. And it's, you know, it's affecting our, you know, how we spend money, what we listen to, and things that really matter. We're not running after it, and especially when it comes down to our youth. And of course, it's not all youth, but it's a large segment that is being caught up in the prison and jail systems. And I believe that it's important, you know, that the churches, I'm definitely going to speak first as a Christian, that the churches definitely need to step up. And and community centers mm-hmm. need to step up mm-hmm. and have things that's geared to the youth. And really, and when I say geared to the youth, really talking about these issues that's detrimental to them, understanding where they came from, understanding slavery, understanding Jim Crow, and understanding the civil rights movement, and then seeing what's going on today. Because many of them don't have an appreciation for what has been done for them, but if they don't know what is what their people have been through, and it's broken down how certain things are being placed to get them to repeat some of the things, but in a, just a different way, because basically all jails and prisons are like plantations.
Right, exactly.
And it's not a, you know, necessarily, you know, I tell them a lot of times, you in this jail, you in this prison, you can't even get around unless master control.
Right.
Give you permission.
Right.
Give me permission to get through one door or another.
Right.
And, but again, that is it's this self-perpetuating thing that is not necessarily someone only with a whip, but the garbage is out there. And people know that you'll listen to this garbage, you'll watch this garbage, and you'll follow suit. You'll dress with your pants sagging and don't realize this stuff came from the prison and the jail.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Yet we glorify it and make it fashionable.
Right.
You know, so things like that. I'm praying that community and statewide, that leaders in the communities will wind up really saying, hey, we got a human emergency going on with our youth. The shootings in Chicago and stuff. And had some serious and quick and get the politics out the way. Really, some tough language. When I say language, I mean, you know, preaching the truth.
Right.
Of what is really affecting our youth, and one of the things it's going to cause some people to lose money. It's going to cause some people to lose friends, but it needs to be spoken.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
And that's what I'm hoping. Even when you see this thing with the, you know, the Sterling situation, you know, it doesn't relate necessarily to the youth. People, men of color, as far as athletes, need to learn how to step up their game to speak out on some of these same issues.
Right. That's true, right, too, because
they have a responsibility, Jim Brown and some of the other ones, before we would speak out on some of the issues that was detrimental to their people.
Right. That is definitely not.
It affects all people.
Right.
Because when African Americans and people of color are not doing their part, whether white America realizes it or not, it affects them. Right. Because we're all connected. The human race.
Right. Right. And there's definitely not enough of that going on. And especially in their situation and their status, because they're the ones that are being looked up to.
Yeah.
So it's even easier for them to get, you know, step out and reach out, going to the neighborhoods, the communities, and abroad to get positive messages out. But it's just unfortunately not being done. As you said, back in the day, those type of things, I mean, you saw a whole lot of that going on. you know, that people coming out in a public stance and trying to gear things out there towards positivity. And so now that's just lost. And that's one of the things that we're trying to do now. I mean, today, trying to be a voice where that is not lost completely. It's still out there. So, I mean, yeah, I had another question, but you ran right into that. In terms of, you know, what would your message be to youth out there to avoid being brainwashed or you know, to just try to combat against that? But you already answered that pretty much.
Well, let me piggyback on that then, because I have a perception. Mm-hmm. You know how they say in life, sometimes things that make you happy make you cry.
Yes.
And my reference is to education. Education is very necessary, but education is also a big part of the problem. Because with every generation, when you know about the previous generation and invention and things that they have achieved and accomplished, the generation coming behind them, it piques their curiosity, they get involved in it, and they take it to another level. But in the educational system today, they don't teach you about your background, so you're learning about someone else's culture. Mm. You see what I'm saying? And as minimal as it may seem, that's so important. And there's supposed to be people working on that aspect of things now, that from preschool up to a point, maybe high school, because then at that point in time, when you go to college, you really know yourself and your culture and where you're coming from. So now your courses that you select from that point on is going to reinforce who you really are about. But that's where the primary problem comes from, is educational system, and we all need it. But you have to also address the educational system. And another thing too is these so-called studies. It inundates the kids and the culture in general with negativity. You know, you're always subservient. You're always a zero. You know, this also adds to the problem with kids, because whenever you see something on TV or a study, whatever, it's always negative. And as opposed to people not accepting that, we'll embrace it and run with it. For instance, an example like HIV. You know, when AIDS first came to the United States, it was Caucasian homosexuals. I'm not getting into a thing, but this is the factual thing. And then it quieted down. Mm. And when it came back again, it was in Africa as a virus, an epidemic. And then from Africa, then it came to the black community. People have to stop, and then now we go on TV and you know, they think they're doing a positive thing, but in reality, you're allowing someone else to dictate who you are. And my point is that these studies need to be, like you said a moment ago, that's the new lynching or the new, you know, plantation type thing. You got to stop embracing these studies, because it's not, studies can be manipulated.
Right.
Absolutely. If I got time to just respond to what Doc said.
Sure, go ahead.
It is, Doc. The fear of God, our youth, you go back in time, most youth, especially here, those before me, my grandfather's age, they had a fear of God, and they had an understanding of what people behind them had done.
Exactly.
To pave the way for them. When you don't know who you are, you are bound to misbehave. You're bound to misbehave. These youth, many of you, especially in the street, being come to the jails, and they don't know who they are. And it is, and I mentioned to many of my white brothers and sisters about the importance. You know, because of course they ask, you know, I have white brothers and sisters, they ask questions about, you know, the youth and why, you know, they call themselves the N-word, and that hopefully be another conversation.
Right, yeah.
And things like that. And I have to let them know a little bit about myself. In that, for a while, I almost got caught up in a lot of things. I did not understand, first of all, my spiritual history and accomplishments. And then at the same time, I did not know about slavery. I didn't really understand I heard about slavery, you know, you see roots and stuff, but at the same time, I didn't know about Jim Crow. I didn't know how systematically, after the Civil War, Reconstruction was started, And African Americans, blacks were able to get, starting to get land, starting to get into the political process. You know, you had people, you know, in politics. And then that was stopped purposely to, and these Jim Crow laws came about to take that away, to take away self-empowerment, to take away trying to have your own schools, to still to read, to write, to be able to vote. The Klan was started right after Reconstruction.
Right, right.
And so when you realize, you know, that when you apply that to today, that one of the main things that someone takes from you, you know, is, you know, someone's quick to kick you out of school, that, you know, once you...
So true.
The media, again, going back to the radio and the media, they want you distracted and to consume those things, but don't pick up a book. Don't aspire to be an educator. Don't aspire to be a doctor. Don't aspire to be a lawyer, but be a rapper, be a football player, be a basketball player. Everything from an African-American male's perspective, from youth, most of the ones that they see that's productive or successful are playing basketball, playing football, singing and dancing. I mean, you got all
right,
acting.
Right.
But there's many more things to us as a people, you know, through our history that we were doing.
Yeah, but see, that's why I was saying that when I talked about knowing your previous generation, my point was that I was trying to say is that we have a lot of people that have invented things, have created things, have did a lot of, you know, scientific stuff, technology, you know, whatever. And I'm saying when you know that as a kid, then that piques your curiosity. Then you start looking into, you know, different scientific things and whatever. Now you're into, now you're turned on. Now you take it to another level. And that's what I'm talking about. We have inventors, scholars, you know, all kind of people. We never hear about them. But I'm saying that's the kind of thing that you've been cut off from your history. That's why I say education is for a particular a group. And they say that's why you need to know your generation and your culture.
Yes.
Well, with that,
we could cut it off, but
it's not the end. The good thing, the good news is it's not the end.
Part two, three, four, five.
This could be ongoing.
But before we go, we're getting close to that time, but before we go, I just wanted to ask Antwaun also, or we wanted to ask Antwaun, is there anything that you would like to share with us in terms of projects or anything that you're working on currently at the moment before we close out? Because you're definitely coming back again.
I just want to say, viewers out there, please be patient. The book is still in process. Mm-hmm. Lord knows I wanted this thing out a long time ago, but things need to be right. So there's some things I'm still considering, some things I may have to add, and some things actually I've learned that might have to go into this book. So be patient. but I'm not going to put any dates and times
right now.
Be patient with me. I ask everybody out there to pray, because some of the book, matter of fact, it's going to touch on a lot of things that we're talking about in some type of way.
Okay.
My life history, my story.
Okay.
And it touches on a lot of things, on identity, who you are. Because once you know who you are, when that self-esteem is there, your mindset, you see how valuable you are. Your mindset changes.
Exactly.
To want to be involved. You care about yourself and you care about your neighbor, no matter what the color, no matter what the gender. So.
Exactly.
All right. So definitely something to look forward to. And for those who recall our first appearance with Antwaun on the show, the book is coming, as he said. So, you know, just pray for him, be patient, and once it comes out, you know, when you take time to develop a product and you make sure it's right, the wait is worth it, because then you got your finished product. It's really going to be enjoyable, and that's what we're talking about right here today. It's going to be, once it's completed, the book will be out. It'll be finished. It'll be a wonderful read, and it'll be, and everybody will say that, oh man, this was worth the wait. so we definitely look forward to that opportunity. But just to mention, as a matter of fact, we don't have a date for this next show that we're doing, with Antwaun, but it is and I'm not going to give the title, but it's definitely going to be another one to see. Coming soon. But we don't want to give out too much information. But from before, we know that everybody, many of you enjoyed listening to Antwaun and as he gave his perspective on his career, working in the juvenile justice system, what he does for youth, and how he is in his career trying to make a difference and spraying not only just talking talk, but he's also walking the walk. So we definitely commend you on that. As for us, is no notes. What can I say? You know, we certainly appreciate you. We thank every fan, wherever you are, here and abroad. We sure appreciate you. We know that you're the reason why we're here, and we appreciate your feedback, your comments, your suggestions. Please continue to bring those forth as we do look at all that, and we do respond back. And it gives us an idea and understanding of how to better serve you with the content that we provide. So check us on Facebook, Twitter, YouTube. You can email us at thenonoshow@aol.com. You can contact us by phone, 610-626-0454. Please continue to let us know how we're doing so we can better serve you. Am I right, gentlemen?
No doubt. I did all that.
So that brings us to the end of this episode. I tell you, time flies when you're having a great conversation. We just don't want it to end, but we, you know, all good things come to an end every once in a while, so that's okay.
True that.
That's okay. So thanks for joining us for this one, and until next time, it's a pleasure, Antwaun. Thank you for coming back on the show. We're already looking forward to your next appearance on the show.
I can't wait.
Right, because it's going to be another great topic.
I'm already juiced up. I'm ready to go again.
So we're going to let our doc here close us out as he... Whoa. Heavy on the mic. Sorry about that, folks.
Let's
close it out as he always... I guess that's our cue.
Yep.
Time to cut it off. So until next time, don't forget to taste the No Notes experience. And Doc...
We'd like to wish you peace, love, and soul.
Until next time, peace.